Hello, everyone. I have a pair of what looks like brand new glasses. They're still on the plastic thing that they come on the shelf that were found. So if these are your glasses, we have them up here. Nobody lost their glasses. All right, we're going to get started pretty shortly here. We're just waiting on a few more people, so hang tight, and we're going to start in a minute or two. All right, so we're just waiting for a few more people to take their seats and get going. But I do want to take this opportunity to acknowledge the territory that we're on. So I want to take the opportunity to acknowledge the traditional territories of the people of the Treaty 7 region in southern Alberta, which includes the Blackfoot Confederacy, comprising of Siksika, Piikani, and Kainai First Nations, excuse me. Thank you. The Tsuut'ina First Nation and the Stoney Nakoda. And the city of Calgary is also home, of course, to the Métis Nation of Alberta, Region 3.
Okay, so with that, we're going to get started. Lisa will be going through this presentation for us this afternoon. And I just wanted to also acknowledge that Dr. Maurice has donated 20% of all of her book proceeds to the Cindy Gladue fund here. So I'd like to give her a round of applause. And with that, take it away, Lisa.
Well, good afternoon, everyone. I hope everyone enjoyed their lunch. I think the food so far has been absolutely fabulous. So hopefully it continues that way for the rest of the weekend. But I know they're not in earshot, but my compliments to the chefs and all the people that work at putting our food together. My name is Lisa Pigeau. I work as a senior political advisor with the LFMO Otipemisiwak. Prior to that, I was 20 years with the Métis Nation of Ontario, doing mostly frontline work, but my most important and my most enjoyable job in Ontario was working with the Métis Nation of Ontario Women's Council. But here I am at the national level, rocking it. I have roots all across the homeland, from British Columbia to Alberta, Saskatchewan, and into Manitoba, and of course my Ontario roots. So I feel a specific affinity to Alberta. This is where my grandfather passed away, a grandfather I never got to meet. So every time I come to Calgary, I think of him, and even though I didn't meet him, I thank him for the gifts that, through his DNA, were passed on to me. We have a little bit of a change in the presentations today. We have another meeting going on, so I'm going to just jump right in here. We are going to keep it to the strategic planning session, then we're going to go into the MMIWG work today, and then we will be doing an honoring and a moment of silence. It is October 4th today, and today is the day we honor sisters in spirit, so we will be marking that a little later on today. So before we get going, is there any questions or comments? Or all righty then. So in 2013, the LFMO Otipemisiwak, with the help and engagement from across the homeland, defined their strategic plan for the next 4 years. But here we are in 2019, and it's time to review that work to make sure it is still relevant. What our strategic plan is to do is to define our goals and strategies, to communicate those goals. It's really important when we're entering into some kind of activity or a project that we have the strength and the input from the women behind us. And so that's why we want to communicate our goals clearly. We're building a sense of ownership in the plan with our organizations and the women's organizations across the homeland. And also, these strategic plans bring together everyone's best interest. So what this does for us is we ensure that that our work is effective, and that we're engaging in activities on the focus and on the key priorities as set out. And it really does provide us a baseline of measurement of how we've done in the last 5 years in keeping to that plan. Bottom line, it connects us all and encourages that concept of a strong and effective network of Métis women. So again, back in 2013, this is a vision and mission work that was set forth. So I think today we had a lot of heavy data this morning. So today's going to be, this afternoon, a little more interactive. And we are really asking you from the bottom of our hearts if you would really provide us with your honest feedback and input, because we truly translate that into activities. So the first little part, and I think Melanie mentioned it this morning, even our guests in the sides of the room, if you want to contribute to this portion, you're more than welcome to. But of course, the delegates around the table, we are really turning to your support to help guide us. So in 2013, LFMO stated their vision is to be an organization of strong Métis women who are the voice of women in the Métis Nation, with a significant role in enhancing the socioeconomic and cultural well-being of all Métis people. So my first question to you, 6 years later, is this vision still where we need to be? Do we need to revisit this vision statement? Is it still valid? And is it encompass enough of what our vision is as Métis women across the homeland. So I'd like to, just for this first part, because I know we haven't had an opportunity to hear from many people this morning, I'm just going to put it out there and ask you to, turn on your mic and provide us any feedback on the existing vision statement for LFMO. And we have some people to the right that's going to capture any additional notes, and then we'll go back and wordsmith this and bring you back a new mission and vision statement as need be. So do we have any brave person that wants to come forward and talk about first this vision statement as it exists now? So does it, so hearing none as of yet, and that's okay. That means we're close to being where we need to be. But is it our vision that we want to, it's our role as Métis women to enhance the socioeconomic and cultural well-being of all Métis people as the life bearers and the carrier of the waters. Is that our role as Métis women? There's a really bright light back there, and I can't see to the back of the room, and I know there's a hand somewhere. Is there a way we can turn that light off?
That light right there.
Turn it off, but we're recording it, and it's going
to, okay, no problem. So if I can't see you back at the back of the room, please maybe just speak into your mic and I'll identify you. I can't see back there. So I do know there was a question or a comment back there.
It's Suzanne Jackson from Ontario, Region 9. Can I use this mic instead? Just so I'm... the only thing that thought that I have on the vision statement is perhaps we could include somewhere in our vision statement the identifying, I don't even know how to put it. My concern is I have a deep connection with the Métis women in our area who are veterans. And in our women's organization, there seems to be a shortfall in identifying and recognizing our Métis women veterans, and not just identifying them, but maybe identifying some of their issues, letting them have a voice. So, letting them have a voice so that they recognize or they realize that they are a part of this group, because we don't talk about them.
That's an excellent point, Suzanne. I just think that I'm just going to ask you, and certainly we'll keep note of it, does that belong in our vision statement? Because if you see the vision statement as an overarching, and as we get down to the mission, and specifically the strategic goals and objectives, I would like to suggest perhaps that might be a better place to define that we need a voice for Métis women's veterans, we need a voice for LGBTQ2S+ people. Perhaps that's a little further down in this work. Would you agree to that, Suzanne?
I agree to that, thank you.
Great, so just make sure you capture that. I'd like to thank my today's man of white. This is Kathleen James, new to our team. She's done all our travel and logistics plan, and I just want to point out to her that this is day 21 on the job for her. So I think she's done a fantastic job. Is there any other comments then about the vision statement? Oh, yes.
Hi there. I'm Karen LaRocque. Excuse me, I'm trying to eat lunch, so I apologize. But I'm a staff member for Lafitte de Madeleine in Saskatchewan. And one of the things that I was looking at, and one of the things that we're doing at Lafitte de Madeleine, is because we're looking at government-to-government relationships and nation-to-nation relationships, I have an issue with the word organization. I think when we use the word organization, we're undercutting ourselves. The second thing is we've got to start using jargon such as reconciliation, repatriation, and the stuff that you guys had presented this morning. I think that's very important when we look at a mission statement. We are not just an ad hoc group of Métis women from across Canada. We are a nation of Métis women, and I think we have to start addressing ourselves as such. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Karen, and certainly a very, very valid point. Tifotipemsawak, an organization, and representing the women's organizations throughout the homeland. And it's our Métis Nation governments that are the nation. So we are a portion therein of the nation. So I do agree with you very much that we need to put the word nation in there somewhere. It's a very valid point. And I love your suggestion about reconciliation. It is of the utmost importance right now and very valid. So we will make note of that, Karen. Thank you. And I'm going to ask my chair, since I can't see if there's any hands go up, would you be able to direct that for me? Thank you. So if with those additions, and so a little more finessing as far as we are the voice of women in the Métis Nation and the addition of the Métis governments in that statement, is there any further comments to that regard? Thank you very much. So let's just take a look at the mission statement. I'm sorry, we lost my computer apparently in my excitement here. I unplugged something. I am a tech person's nightmare. So I'll reread the mission statement. To ensure that Métis women from across the homeland are safe, connected, empowered, and have the capacity to work with other Canadian and Métis organizations to help create the conditions for healthy, vibrant, and productive communities throughout the Métis Nation. Okay, I could see where we could make that change, Karen. I assume that was Karen, sorry. And I can't hear very well in the back, so I would encourage you to come forward to a mic if you'd like to add, but I did hear that. Oh, okay.
Adrian, Infinity Women, Manitoba. I just wanted to just pick up on what Minister Campbell talked about a little bit earlier about, is it the role of LFMO to ensure that women across the homeland are safe, or is it the role of LFMO to support the provincial leaders to ensure that the women in their provinces and territories are safe? It's just the perception about the role of LFMO again.
Absolutely.
That Anita talked about.
Absolutely, and I think President O'Manaho reaffirmed that this morning. Okay. So I think that's an excellent point. Thank you very much. Okay. Did you grab that, Kathleen?
I just wanted to make the comment as well as being my name is Kelly Camacho, LMFO Ontario, Region 2. I just wanted to make the statement also that I have the problem with saying just the homeland, because Métis moved across Canada, and a lot of us are from Alberta, Manitoba, Saskatchewan, and we're living in Ontario. And so I'm looking at all these things about homelands and stuff like that, but it should be across Canada, Métis women across Canada. It should be all Métis women.
Thank you very much for that, Kelly. I do have to state that under the organizational structure of LFMO AGM Oct, we are represented by British Columbia, Alberta, Saskatchewan, Manitoba, and Ontario Women's Council. So as such, it is within our mandate to do our work and to influence our work across the homeland. So I do hear what you're saying, and we are spread out across Canada, but as far as LFMO's structure, that is this response. So if anybody else has any comments to that regard, I'd love to entertain them, but just right off the bat, that would be my answer to that one.
Francis?
The question I have here is, our president's not in the room, our leaders are not in the room, so we're doing the vision and mission statements, and what if they come back and we're not getting their input? Those are our leaders, and that those were elected to help us lead, so now they're not in the room and we're going through all this whole process.
No, and very valid point. It is Francis, I can. Very valid point. The leaders are currently in a meeting. And so I just want to assure you that next step in this process would be bringing it back to our board of directors, which is all of our leaders, to validate these words before it comes back to the floor again. Are you still okay with proceeding, Francis?
No, I'm just wondering, we're going to sit here for an hour, and we're going to make all these recommendations and do all this, and what if it's changed again? So that'll be another hour of our day that's going to be focused on strategic planning. So I'm not quite sure why they're not participating with us here today or if there's a problem.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so, and I would anticipate
that
we'll be back shortly.
So what I'd recommend is you go and ask your president if she's going to be part of the group or she's going to, we're not doing it.
Okay. So how about I just step out and I'll make that call. Actually, I'll run upstairs to the meeting, and I will get further clarification on that, Francis. And so I'm going to ask you to just take a 5 to 10 minute break, and I'll reconvene.
The reason I'm saying that is this morning we went through all the process and we went through the presentation that we had, and your president didn't review it. So again, we're going through another process, and they're not in the room here with us. So I know that time is tight and we have a whole bunch of work to do, but if we're not prepared, why are we moving forward?
So right now we're reviewing, and I hear you and I understand that, we're just reviewing the work that was completed in 2013. This is going to be an evolving process over the next year through funding through Women and Gender Equality and our enhanced capacity. This will allow us to do this work over the next year or so. Hearing that comment from the floor, I'd like to just adjourn for a moment and I'll go speak with our leaders and I'll be right back. Thank you.
I'd also like to encourage everyone to stay close to the room. If you'd like to grab a coffee quickly, that's fine, but just so that we can reconvene as soon as Lisa gets back. Okay, everyone, we're going to get started back up in 2 minutes, just allowing everybody to come back into the room. Everybody, welcome back. We're going to get started now, so I'm going to toss the mic over to Lisa.
Welcome back, everyone. Thank you for affording me that time to go speak with our leaders. They will be back very, very shortly. I don't have an exact moment in time, but they will be very back shortly, and they do know that we have some notes being taken right now, and they will review the notes from what has been said prior to them arriving back. So in the interest of hearing from the floor the concern, I'd like to just point us in a different direction until the leaders come back. And so what I'll do to set us a good tone to go into some more group work when the leaders return, I think we'll just go through the existing strat plan, and then we'll come to the questions when the leaders return. Would that be an acceptable approach for everyone? Yes? Okay, great, thank you. So originally, as stated in 2013, LFMO had six goals with several objectives underneath those goals. So the first was to build a strong, successful, and a responsible organization whose voice is heard throughout the Métis Nation. And then the objectives within that are to strengthen our organization, to strengthen our communication approach, to enhance our contribution to Métis policy and governance, and to build capacity for financial management and fundraising. So I'll just do a little bit of a sort of an overview of what has transpired since 2013, since these goals have stated. So the organization exists with a representative from each of the Métis homeland provinces, so that we have five representatives on our board, plus our president, Melanie O'Meniho. As far as strengthening our communication approach, this is a challenge that I think will haunt every organization and every movement going forward, is how to effectively communicate. You can, you know, you have the electronic communications, you have these new social media, platforms that we can communicate through. And we simply do not have the funding to get or the time, and nor do all of you have the ability to come together, let's say, on a monthly basis. So to be able to communicate where we're at is an ongoing process, but I think we have made some strides in improvement. But we do have a ways to go on that, and we've recently engaged Kathleen. She will be helping us to improve our communication approaches from the LFMO perspective. And as far as enhancing our contribution to Métis policy and governance, LFMO AGM sits at the table with the senior officials for the permanent bilateral mechanism. And although we don't have a voting voice, we provide a gender-based analysis perspective when needed. And so certainly that is our role there. And we, to build capacity for financial management, you'll see a little bit more of that tomorrow. The significant changes in terms of that since last year when we all gathered. Goal number two was to be caretakers of traditional knowledge and the voice of Métis women, to remain trusted representatives who advocate on behalf of Métis women, to maintain cultural awareness and resiliency across the homeland in Canada, and strengthen and support citizenship for the Métis Nation. And I think as one previous speaker pointed out, our role is to support our Métis governments. Our role isn't primarily that. Our role is to support our Métis governments. We have noted that change, and we will, you know, going forward in this work, make sure that's included. Goal number three was to ensure that the perspectives of Métis women are included in community economic development initiatives. This was to earlier work that the LFMO AGM Oct PEMSOAC engaged in 2015-16. And I'm hearing a question, so.
There's a question over there.
I have a question, or more of a comment. You said it's important to be a support to our local governments, our Métis nations.
Yes.
I think it's more important to be a part of them as voting members.
Great.
Okay,
thank we'll you. Make that note as well. I'm certainly not in a position to make any kind of fundamental changes. I'm a messenger today, but I will make sure we take note of that comment, and I thank you for that.
You're welcome.
Any other comments? Thanks for helping me, Cassidy. I simply can't see. How about our chairs? They're doing a fantastic job today. Thank you, Cassidy and Genevieve. And so goal number four was to foster culturally appropriate learning environments and lifelong learning to improve the educational outcomes for women and all Métis learners. And the objectives under that goal was to research, develop, and share historical cultural materials, to support programming that helps Métis children and youth to succeed in school, and to build supports for Métis women to pursue education. And certainly from the LFMO AGM PEMSOAC's position, our role is in the policy work that leads to the changes, or lends support to the changes. And again, as President O'Menaho stated this morning, we do not do program delivery. That is not our role as LFMO. Goal number five was to help Métis people lead healthier lives and help create the conditions for healthy and vibrant communities. So through that, promote Métis women's health research and work together to address health issues relevant to Métis women and families. So we heard this morning through the blueprint how important it was to expand our knowledge base. and it's not always through empirical evidence. There's some wonderful work going on throughout the homeland in regards to Métis women's research. And I don't know if she's still in the room today, but Dr. Jennifer Adisi has been working with us and doing some of work, and certainly had a great hand in the development of our MMIWG report. And certain I can't do all her work justice, but I do know that she researches archival data and gathers information from that perspective on Métis women. And I thank her for that work. Goal number six is to advocate on behalf of Métis women for social justice and fairness, to raise awareness and provide support to our elders, to address abuse and violence against Métis women, and advocate for fair and equal treatment for Métis women in Canada's justice system, and mobilize a nation Bring the Children Home Committee. So I can report that from LFMO's perspective, we have not, we're not directly responsible for that at this point. So as far as those objectives go, so again, let me go back to the beginning. Goal one is to build strong and successful and responsible organization whose voice is heard throughout the Métis Nation. And respecting the fact that our leaders are not in the room, I'm just going to entertain some comments to that effect at this moment. Would anybody like to comment on that goal? Goal number number two is be caretakers of traditional knowledge and the voice of Métis women. I think that's... I'm just going to have to ask you to use your microphone because I could hear you, but I'm sure the rest of our guests weren't able to hear you, and I apologize for making you repeat it. But I didn't want to stop you mid-sentence. My mother would have come back and tapped me on the shoulder for interrupting somebody.
I'm over 65 and I don't remember what I asked her. I'm hot right now. My question was in terms of the caretakers of traditional knowledge, if we had somewhere in the LMFO office where we're storing information and possibly books and stories, where we have actual copies of those resources available.
Right. Thank Good. You. So at the moment, as people send information, we gather and keep it. Do we have a formal structure in place? I would have to say no. But we have some very generous individuals that have provided some books for a bit of a library. I would, at this point, encourage that that information go to your Métis government at present, because I think that's where it would make an immediate impact. But if you wanted to share in addition to your government, your Métis government in your province, then we would be grateful. And we heard very much from Jean Taillé last night and our role as Métis women in keeping that traditional knowledge and sharing it to the to future generations. And I know, without doing too much counting in here, I know of at least 12 knowledge keepers that I've asked for support over the years for traditional knowledge, and I want to thank you all. We have a very deep wealth of knowledge sitting in this room right now. So goal number three was to ensure the perspectives of Métis women are included in community economic development initiatives. And four was to foster culturally appropriate learning environments and lifelong learning to improve the educational outcomes for Métis women, or for women and all Métis learners. So I do know that's the work very much within our Métis governments. They do that work, and so from our perspective, from a national perspective, we would create opportunities and policies that would, help to support and ensure that a Métis woman's voice is loud and strong. So that would be our role. Is there any comments to that effect? And so researching, developing, and sharing the historical cultural materials, I think that's a work in progress, and that's going to be something that we will be doing for generations to come, is to develop and share that information, so we ensure that we honor the lives of those people within our nation that have come before us, and we learn from their work that they've done as we move forward on our journey. And goal number five was to help Métis people lead healthier lives and help create conditions of healthy and vibrant communities. Is there any comment to that regard? I've heard often
Lisa. As we will look through these goals, I'm just wondering how we can take it back to the conversation, because it sounds through the goals that LFMO is providing like frontline sort of support and programming. Mm-hmm. So I think, and innocently, I think the goals were set from the mission, and now if we're making a change to the mission, do we need to adjust the goals to reflect the more specific role of LFMO, because it sounds like with all the goals, LFMO is involved in direct programming and support, as opposed to supporting the governments or the female leaders in the provincial governments.
Right.
So it's when you go through them, I just think, is that the role of yours, and then where does the provincial leadership fit into that? So I think it's just a clarification and wording of the mission, vision, and objectives. So maybe that's a conversation that has to happen when everybody's back in the room.
And you know what? That's exactly where we are at with it. And thank you very much for speaking those words. That's some of these goals and objectives don't speak immediately to our reality. And I couldn't agree with you more on that comment. And so this is the work that, so this is very initial work in building this new strategic plan for Les Femmes Chefotipemsoek. And so we will hear what you have to say, and we will do it justice in the process over the next little while, because certainly LFMO is not a service provider, period. We do not do programs, period. That is the role of the Métis governments, and of course, as it works within each of the provinces, I know there's some differences, but that's the role of the Métis women's organizations throughout the homeland, not LFMO. Certainly, we work on the policy end of things, and I hope that is helpful.
I think it's just that if we're feeling a bit confused about the wording, that anybody who reads this, who's looking at provincial funding, or sorry, national funding or national leadership, might be a bit confused too in terms of the roles and responsibilities of the various levels of government.
Absolutely, and that's where we knew we needed to change this, to update it as things evolve. So thank you very much for that, and certainly we'll incorporate that in our work in the next year and a half. Yes?
Sorry, following up on what this lady was saying, I'm wondering, is it part of the role of the national level to find dollars to get down to the provincial level to provide some of these services?
I'm going to ask you to rephrase your question, because I'm not sure I understood the fullness of it.
I am wondering, because we're putting all these goals and objectives up there, is part of the role of the national level to find dollars for the programming that we're talking about to get it down to the provincial level?
Thank you very much for adding that in. Now I do understand
Makes sense?
Your question. And certainly advocacy on behalf of Métis women is a goal, is prime one for Les Femmes Chefotipemsoek, and at the tables at which we sit, is to really ensure that the reality of Métis women is expressed at funding tables, at other areas that could possibly contribute to better outcomes within our provinces. We do not create those changes within the provinces, but it would be our hope and our goal to create those pathways for you. Does that answer your question?
Not really.
Okay, let me...
I'm wondering if you guys do any work towards getting the dollars, money, to hand down to the provincial levels. Not the ideas or the concepts, the dollars.
So the dollars itself... we can only invoke change in ensuring that the Métis women's reality, and it would be the decision of the funders, but I can assure you that is our day-to-day work. And we have more avenues opening up for us that, in my 20 years working with Métis women, I've never seen opened up before. And so that has translated modestly, down to the provincial levels right now, but there's lots of more work to be done in that department to getting that funding down to the provinces. Is that closer? I know it's not the answer you wanted, but that's our reality right now. So, I will defer more of that question to when President O'Menahoe gets back, because I'm sure she can answer more it more in fullness. There's a red light back there.
I was wondering, it might be helpful to put the objectives in more specific, actionable terms.
Okay.
If we are moving forward with this, that reflects the current reality within the next 5 years, so more on like what the national level supports can be that we can't get at the provincial level, even though I completely agree with defining the roles and the comments made.
Okay.
So around policy and, like you say, trying to reflect a national level reality from AT women and the advocacy being more specific instead of just saying promote.
Right. Were you able to grab that? So I guess the important is to focus on the advocacy piece, which speaks to more of our reality as Le Femme Chef. Thank you very much for that. That's an excellent point.
I struggle with this mic. Oh, Adrian, Infinity Women. Yeah, that's a really good point. And I was just wondering if we could actually have another section that says not just objectives, because those are vague, but then have outcomes or actionable items or outcomes, because then it's measurable and we can look year from year. What have we achieved?
Perfect.
What's measurable and how do we measure them? So that I struggle with this mic. So we can really see from year to year the outcomes that we've achieved and what we still need to do, because objectives are very broad and they can't be measured. Like words like promote and work together, you can't really measure those. But if you were to say promote and then have ways that you're going to promote it, then you can measure we've achieved those from year to year. So,
with
timelines.
Okay, so would it be fair to say then we would need sort of goal, objective, activities,
and
timelines is what you'd like to see in the perfect.
Well, then I think it helps to sort of identify what we're going to do and when we're going to do it from year to year, so that we're not just having these vague, because I mean that's where you start, right, is objectives, but when you break it down into measurable action items, then it's easier to measure every year how much we've achieved.
Perfect.
And what we still need to do.
Excellent. Thank you very much for that. I would agree very much with putting those activities as well as the timelines in. It keeps everything at the focus as well when we have those timelines, and when we're planning our work for the next year, we know what our priorities are. So that's perfect. Thank you. This is just very much a shortened version. The whole 2013 strategic plan is available on our website. I don't believe we put copies of this in our kits because we knew it had to be revisited. Any other comments as far as the structure of what you'd like to see in our strategic plan? So we have a very, very great, a good recommendation about breaking it down to activities and timelines. Is there anything further? On the back? I can't see, sorry.
And just be sure to state your name and where you're from, please.
It's Jelida Lajmodier, Manitoba. The question I have is, I'm looking at the, it's, I mean, I'm not new to looking at this in terms of the mission and goals and objectives, but one of the points that I'm thinking about is in terms of identity, the question of identity. And when I look at the mission of LFMO, you know, to ensure that Métis women, and it talks about Métis women consistently along with within the six strategic goals, but there's also I had to write it out because I couldn't remember all the letters and the LGBTQ2S plus, and I know there's women right across in all of those categories. I'm just wondering, like when you're talking about your strategic goals, you're talking about Métis women. I guess when I think of gay,
there's men that are also gay. So are we talking the men as well? And I don't think that that's the function of the LFMO. I just need the clarity or a clear understanding of it. I think, you know, it is the function or one of the expectations that I would have as a Métis woman, that the LFMO would protect my identity and would ensure that, you know, my identity is protected as well as a Métis woman. So I'm just unclear about how that fits in, so that I don't know what, if my question is more confusing than anything, but it's what's running around in my head. So I apologize if I'm confusing everybody, but it's not clear to me then how does the LGBT Q2S plus, wow, that that acronym, how does it fit in with the goals when we're referencing Métis women, or are we redefining what the definition is of Métis women?
Thank you very much for that, Jelida. And I see our president walked back in the room just at a very opportune time. And I understand what you're saying. And we've changed some of the verbiage, you know, some of our explanations, and you'll see within our MMIWG report that we have used Métis women and persons who identify as LGBTQ2S+, or women-identified people. We've used all of those words, but now I'd love to open it up to the floor for some more discussion around there, and perhaps President Omenaho can help guide that portion. See how I did that? See how I did that?
Yeah.
Talk about skill, right?
Hi, Charlotte Nolan, Infinity Women, and Two-Spirit Midshift Local from Manitoba, the first of its kind in the Métis homeland. When we use those acronyms, we're talking about human beings. When we use the word women, we're talking about human beings. And I'm 68, so I've got a few years on this. I need to make it clear to everyone that's here that for so long we were forgotten. We were put back in the bush because even our own mothers didn't want to talk to us. As a woman, I stand up for myself. And I stand up for my sisters. And I hope that as we move forward, that the two-spirit people, LGBTQ and all the other acronyms, I don't know, we're human beings. Let's not separate one another. So with the vision, the mission, the goals, the objectives of the work that the LMNO are going to be conducting over the next however long they're in existence, let's always remember that, first and foremost, we're all human beings. And that if we're going to get anywhere, if we're going to make strides to save this planet, we need to do it as nations. And there's only one race, and that's the human race. It doesn't matter what other acronyms or titles we give them. So in the work that we do, let's always remember that. Thank you.
So I know I came in a bit on the middle of this. So there's a few things, actually. I know I met with Charlotte several years back already, and I did tell her, I am not somebody that's afraid to open my world and open my arms to accept anybody, and we do, and that's what I wanted to do, was to create a safe place for all women, whether it's part of our LGBTQ2S+, or whatever alphabet soup they try to create for people. And I agree with you, Charlotte. I hate it. I tell everybody, I hate how, because we're uncomfortable to talk about things around sexuality and people's gender choices and those things, and because we don't have a place of comfort in those conversations, we come up with an acronym to try to hide from it. And we need to stop hiding from it. They're a part of our community, and they're a part of who we are. And we need to love and accept them as part of our community and who we are, and not make people feel like they have to hide in the closet anymore. So I am hoping that no matter where we go and what we do, that we do have a space for them. But I also want to say this, and I have said it before, I can't be a voice for them. I have walked around for many decades saying nothing about us without us. Well, I say the same thing for them, nothing about them without them, because I can't tell you what their walk is, what their experiences are, and what their needs are. They have to come and tell us, and we just have to be open-hearted enough to help support that and make that happen. So, Charlotte, I do welcome you here. I'm grateful you're here. I'm grateful that you've been an amazing voice. I'm happy and very proud that you have a local. And I want all of us, and we need to, we were just talking as a board, and these are all very old strategic planning documents, and they happen, a lot of these conversations happened pre-2010. We need to go back and revisit things so that they are as inclusive as we want to be and are receptive and responsive to everybody that's here and the changing growth that we've had.
Thank you very much, Melanie, for that explanation. You walked in at just the perfect time. Hi, Jelida.
I feel like I've opened up a can of worms, and that certainly wasn't my intent. And I would like to just clarify that the question I had to do with definition. I wasn't speaking against any human race or any part of the human race. And I forget that whole acronym, the two-spirit plus, as it ends in that group, within in Manitoba. There is a local. It belongs, and it's a member of the Manitoba Métis Federation, not the Infinity Women's Secretariat. We welcome them, we support them, and because they're our family. I'm not speaking against that. My question has to do with the definition. You're telling me you represent, and I expect the LFMO to protect my identity as a Métis woman. You talk in here as a Métis woman. Charlotte identifies as a Métis woman. I'm not disputing that. All I'm saying is you need to have a definition. In Manitoba, that group, that particular group, and I'm saying that group only because I can't remember all the, I have to learn to, that acronym, and I don't want to mix it up, so I'll just say that acronym representing the particular, and that part of our family is a member of the Manitoba Métis Federation and not the Infinity Women's Secretariat. So I think we're mixing up, or maybe I misunderstood, but I go back to my question. Are you representing, who are you representing? I thought you were representing me as a member of Métis Women, because your language speaks to it, our language speaks to it.
I want to tell you that, and I have said this, I've reported on this several times, the government comes to us and asks us to speak on behalf of the LGBTQ2S plus community. It's a lot like they try to fit everything into the same round hole all the time. And when I first actually went and talked to Charlotte and some others, it was because I'm not comfortable being the voice of their community. And I told them that I wanted to create a space where they could be their own voice. So I am the national person who represents the voice of Métis women, and I understand that that's the mandate that I've been given. And all I'm trying to do, and maybe Anita's going to help me out here a bit, all I'm trying to do is create a space so that Charlotte and any others that want to come forward and have a place to speak on behalf of the LGBTQ2 community can. I've actually offered to help them and assist them in creating their own national organization if they think that's beneficial. I don't know what they want, though. And we had an LGBTQ2 panel last year, and that was part of the question that we put in front of them. What would you like? Because you can't let this 61-year-old woman be your voice, because she hasn't got a clue what it's like to be you. So you have to be able to create your own enterprise. If that's us having some kind of a chapter that gives them the opportunity. But I understand now the good news of this is that if the Liberal government is still in, they have created money or resources for the LGBTQ2 community to start creating some of their own infrastructure and enterprise. I support that. I'm not trying to be their spokesperson at all. And they've never asked me to be their spokesperson. So, Jelida, I do represent you, wherever you went, but but I'm not trying to be the person or the voice or the knowledge keeper of anything other than what I've been given a mandate for. But I do want to create a safe space for everybody here.
So I just... I just was going to let you know that I received a text message from the back of the room since I can't see back there. Dr. Adesi wanted to mention something as well, but I don't see where she is.
Thank you. So I'm not sure what I missed. Sorry, we weren't trying to be disrespectful to the group that's here. We were actually trying to work out some administrative and budgeting and those kind of things that are coming up in the next little while. So we had a quick board meeting to straighten out some things so that we're more somewhat more prepared, I think, for the next 2 days. And what's going to happen actually was, and Melanie had mentioned that we were talking actually about the mission and vision statement that's up there, and it's something that we should be bringing forward and having those conversations with respect to changing them. And trying to keep with the times, I'll say. So just a little bit of how we got to the panel, because one of the panel that we brought forward last year, one of the, I guess, promises that we tried to make was that we would try to be inclusive of representation from that community. And so when we were putting together who would be brought forward, and Charlotte, I've had the honor of knowing Charlotte for I think almost a year, a little over a year now, and so that's why when we were looking at who our delegation was going to be, a representative from that community had to come with us, and so that local, that's the Two-Spirit Mi'kmaq local that's been created, was brought forward by Infinity Women, by myself to the cabinet to garner support for that local. And so cabinet had provided that support. It actually went through their normal process to be recognized local and then to have the same rights and privileges, I'll say, as any other local that we have within Manitoba. And so that local meets regularly. They have their own activities and whatnot that they're doing. One of the questions that was asked of me when we made some changes to our own bylaws, so Infinity Women's Secretariat bylaws, one of the questions, and of course it came from a man, that asked the question, so what happens if you have a transgender person coming and wanting to be part of your women's organization, is the question that was posed to me. And I said, I don't have the right to determine who you are and what you refer yourself to and to what gender. That's not my responsibility, nor is that my right to do that. I said, whoever identifies as whatever gender that they're, that's what they identify with, that's them. We're not asking for people to come and be part of us to have the proper or different body parts or whatever you want to say, that they identify as a woman, then in our eyes, they're a Métis woman. And so because they were trying to push us in terms of saying that we would be exclusionary with respect to two-spirited people or transgender women that were coming forward and wanting to be part of. And so it's not our right, nor do we have that authority to say that Charlotte can't be part of and shouldn't be part of Infinity Women's Secretariat or even of that local. And so for us, that is the right and responsibility and the authority of Charlotte to determine who she is, and she knows who she is. And I shared with you guys last year, and that's why I'm so passionate about that community, and I joke around with them all the time that you guys have too many alphabets that I can't remember. And I shared with you guys last year that my brother, my late brother, was part of that community, although back then he couldn't identify or say he was, because you just didn't back then. But to me, they'll always have a soft spot in my heart, and I'll always fight for them because I think they have that right to do that. And so for me, that community is a community that I will always support and will always have a spot at our table and always be part of our delegation to bring their own, because we all have individual issues and concerns and ideas, and some of them are phenomenal that we don't all know. And so for me, they'll always be part of the delegation that comes and you know, participates in these forums. It's not, I don't think, for us as LFMO to define Métis women in a sense of what we think Métis women are. It's something I think that we need to just have those conversations and come up with an agreed upon what we think Métis women are, and I don't think we should get into the weeds with it. I don't think we should start minimizing it. I think we should be as inclusive and open as we can with whatever that definition becomes, and I think it needs to be something just real simple. And so for me, to have that as part of those conversations is important, just no different as it is to have youth sitting around our table. Because one day each one of us won't be sitting at this table, and you're hoping that the young people will be sitting here and will be, you know, part of that history and know how we got to where we are today. So thank you very much for allowing me to speak.
All right, so we have a bit of a speakers list going here. So we have Karen, then Angel, and then Jennifer.
You know, I've struggled with this for a while. I know last year at the AGM, I watched the live stream. And my daughter was part of the delegation, and my daughter is a lesbian. And one of the things that she told me was that, you know, Mom, when I went to the table, this is fairly new to like LMFO. I said, yes. And she said, we have a varying gender, like age range. We've got some younger ladies, we've got some older generation. And she said, one of the things that was coming out of the meeting was folks coming up to me because they openly knew that I was a lesbian, and I'm very vocal. I said, yep. They'd come up to me, she said, and they'd ask me questions. With Lafitte de Madeleine in Saskatchewan, we are actually having an MMIWG event, and during that event, we're also welcoming our LGBTQ2S+ community to Lafitte. And so what we're doing is we made contact with an organization that can come out and do a workshop with us. because I think if we are treading into this and we are going to open our arms up to our sisters, that we have to be knowledgeable. One of the things that has to absolutely happen is we talk about education for this, that, the other. We need to be educated on our sisters. We have to be politically correct. When someone comes up to the mic and asks a question, because they are not knowledgeable, because like I said, this is fairly new, we have to be accepting. We have to provide that safe environment so that these important questions can be asked. Most definitely, I think there needs to be a definition. We have a definition for everything else, and in order for us to have a safe environment where we can ask those questions, not feel like we're being unkind, unfair, but accepting, and in that acceptance, asking the proper questions, ensuring that we're being inclusive, ensuring that everybody sitting around this table feels like they're part of this organization or this nation of women. I think it's imperative that we have some sort of workshop and that we do determine for ourselves, rather than have the Liberal Party come and ram down our throats, who and what Lafitte de Madeleine are going to represent and do. I think it's imperative that we have that type of a workshop where everybody is educated, and when we move forward, we're moving forward in a good way. Thank you.
Angel?
Hello, my name is Angel Robinson. I'm from British Columbia. I'm the LGBTQ2S+ representative for my community. I just want to clarify that LGBTQ2S+ and women aren't exclusive demographics to identify with. You can be a woman and be LGBTQ2S+ at the same time. So I think it does an injustice to separate those categorically. They're overlapping identities in many cases. I also want to echo the thought that was just expressed, that there needs to be more education throughout our nations, in particular about being politically correct, for lack of a better word, being respectful towards people who identify as LGBTQ2S+. I also ask as a personal request that I know that the acronym can be confusing and conflicting, but I do ask that you try to get it right, because it does mean something, and it may not mean something to everybody, but it will mean something to some of the people who are watching us on the live stream right now and who are seeing us represent their voices. Thank you.
All right, Jennifer.
I don't know how to use technology. Tansay, I'm Jennifer Adese. I'm sitting on the outside. I'm not a part of the delegations, but I'm a Métis woman and a professor at the University of Toronto. And I contributed a portion to the MMIWG report that you're going to look at. I would encourage you to take a look at the historical context there for getting some language around how to talk about this. Because as a researcher who teaches this to students every day, I felt it was really important to use the language of cisgender Métis women to clarify that when I'm writing, I'm speaking to what we would call cisgender Métis women. Women whose gender identities align with the sex that they were assigned at birth. Because I can't speak for trans Métis women, and I don't have that research and knowledge, but there is a language there available for us to use to make these kinds of conversations more readily understood. And I think it's, you know, part of it is coming to become comfortable with the term. So thank you for, you know, speaking out and saying, like, the term itself is important. If we can say Tchaikovsky and we can say Wakotwin, we can definitely figure out LGBTQ2S and QQIA+ that is sometimes at the end of it. But as a researcher, as a teacher, what I can say is that gender discrimination has impacted the entire Métis nation. So the importation of values of Catholicism meant also the importation of ideas about gender difference, which were not indigenous to any Indigenous people. And that's a process carried out through around the world. So there is a language available to us to address, I think, the concerns about, you know, clarifying who LFMO is primarily speaking to. But I just wanted to kind of flag that as a researcher, because I did try to inbuild the language in the historical context for that part. I'll stop jumping in now.
So, mostly to Angel and to anybody else out there, Jennifer just exactly demonstrated why I'm not crazy about the acronym. It isn't because I can't say LGBT2Q plus or S plus. It's because people keep changing the acronym. And we need to come to a place where we make a place of safety for the community, the LGBTQ2 community, to come together and identify how they really want to be identified, rather than having new people come in and changing it all the time so that it just becomes even more intimidating. But I do also support what Karen had raised earlier and what you've also put forward. Education is so important on these factors. I know I can be a smart ass sometimes, but the reality is that when somebody comes to me and starts having conversations around things like binary and non-binary, and I want to be referred to as us and them, or her and that, or whatever it is, I don't understand all of that. It isn't that I don't want to know. It's that there's nowhere to take a course on this stuff, and we need to create some space so that we're learning and we're being respectful and understanding of each other. So I do really appreciate the fact that we do need to, and that's part of maybe what we can put in our move forward actions for next year, is to have some work done and get a group like maybe what Karen was talking about to come in here and start talking about these things. And also by giving some more space to our LGBTQ2 community as to how they want us to work with them and how they want us to refer to them, and creating that opportunity for us to be real partners in this moving forward.
Thank you, Melanie. It's been not as planned this afternoon, but it's exactly the way it was meant to be. And I thank you for all your time in the process. And I thought it was very important that we continue on with the conversation. We have some takeaways and lessons learned today. And I really turn to all you, all of the women in this room, all the people in this room, to help lead us in formulating this strategic plan. Our break is available now, so I think this is a natural time in the agenda where we should take a few minutes, and we'll have I'll have a discussion with President Omenaho and be advised on what our next steps in the agenda will be. So the snack is just outside the doors as the rest of the day, and I'll ask our chairs what time we need to be back.
So we'll take a 15-minute break and meet back at